all for being here. So glad to see such a good turnout. Welcome to the inaugural session of the inaugural Global Gab Fest. GAB being short for the Graduate Advisory Board of the Institute of Humanities and Global Cultures. I'm Vic Sabo. I'm a grad student in the music department. And we are so happy to see all of you here to engage in this GAB Fest. You know, the name, I think, sort of at least attempts to capture what we're going for here. Something a little looser than, say, your average conference where, you know, you have the presenter and then the solemn and somewhat anxiety-ridden Q&A. And we really wanted this to be much more open sort of discussion. So, wanted to direct your attention to a few things. We are having a reception at 5 at Boiler Heights, so all of you are invited to that. Also wanted to direct your attention to the wonderful website of the Institute, virginia.edu/humanities. You can check out all the events that the Institute is putting on. And finally, that we will be live tweeting throughout the day as part of the experimental nature, say, of this GabFest. And so hashtag GabFest12, go ahead and tweet away in the middle of the session. We'll see how that works out. So without further ado, I'll introduce, I'd love to introduce Lindsay, who's working, who's here at Open Ground.
I'm Lindsay Hepler. I'm a program manager here at Open Ground, so I just wanted to welcome you all here today. We're very excited to have the inaugural GAB Fest in our studio. Just a couple of housekeeping things. There are two restrooms in this sort of middle opening of the wall. There's also filtered water in the back if you want water. I think we also have some food and drinks back here. For those of you who have not been to Open Grounds before, welcome. We are a cross-grounds initiative to bring people together in new ways across boundaries for collaboration and conversation, to talk about things, to address issues that are really the most pressing issues in our society right now. So GabFest is a perfect fit for Open Grounds. And if you have any questions about what we do or how to get involved, please let me know.
And also, hopefully, there's a sign-up sheet going around, so if you can get your name and email on there, that would be great. And from here, Krista, why don't you take it away, Krista, together this panel, so.
Experience and my global experience, morphed into more teaching experiences. whether it be semester long, intensive J terms, or co-curricular through the JPC or Erasmus or so on. I've been doing that for over a decade.
My name is Austin Petrick. I'm a graduate student in the English department. I'm interested in transnational modernisms, and I'm also taking part right now in a course that Professor Michael Levinson is teaching. It's a collaborative engagement with students from the University of Delhi.
I'm Brad Brown, and I teach at the Commerce School, and I'm also principal of the International Residence College, which is an undergraduate residence college with an international theme. About half of us are Americans and half are about 40 different countries. I also lead study abroad programs, or I have for the last 18 years, to either Europe, Fiji, or Nicaragua, or Bangladesh. It's hard to get there. And I also, like Bob, I do quite a few JPC and double Google words and the random things we even heard comes up with, I think.
I just wanted to do a brief overview of what I'd like to sort of touch on today, and I know that only an hour can only cover so much. But first, I wanted us to talk about how we might be able to use technology to connect educational communities across the globe, and how people are already doing that. And then the second half of the discussion will be dedicated to how we can develop global communities or foster already existing global communities through research here and abroad. So I'd like to start with Austin, who has very kindly volunteered to describe for us the class that's currently being taught by conservatism, and sort of how it functions, how students are being connected with the university in that.
Sure. So the course title is Virginia Woolf and Bloomsbury Group. It's a sort of intensive exploration, single semester of Virginia Woolf's texts, not only her novels, but also her diaries and letters as well. What's unique about this course, and what was one of the features that attracted me to me, was that we've got a partnership going on with Delhi University students there, a particular English classroom, which is following the same syllabus as we are. And so the relationship is sort of two-part. In the first, students in our classroom are assigned a partner at Delhi University, and we put together a 5 to 10 minute presentation collaboration with that student, and I'll speak more about that relationship in a second. And then the second part of the relationship between the classrooms is the use of the telepresence rooms of the Robertson Media Center in Clemens, and we meet 3 times after a teleconference with that classroom. So the full class sits down, and we can see them through the screen, and also converse at that time. And we've also presented papers to one another's classrooms. I'll speak first to the sort of relationship that's developed through this community. My partner is Tricia Mitra. She's a second-year graduate student in Delhi, and she's interested in gender studies. And one of the things I noticed most was that our conversations began early in the semester with much more general and more broad topics. We started with sports and with family, and then eventually got around to Wolf. She told me about the fact that she was brought up in Lucknow, that she that her parents had moved from Bangladesh. We shared an interest in mountains that she's visited, and I've only watched 2 movies. And we talked about her favorite writers. Last month, she told me that she had been celebrating Durga Puja, which is a major festival in the Bengali community. So this sort of relationship to me was almost more important than what we talked about with Wolf, because it was an exposure to somebody immediately. Where it wasn't just Wolf, which in a certain sense, conversations about Wolf were always conversations about Wolf, but speaking with somebody about their life in that way was really eye-opening. A couple notes about this were that Professor Levinson didn't encourage us to use any particular mode of communication with the student. So we were free to communicate by email, which is what I preferred, although we also connected on Facebook. I've spoken to other students who connected on Twitter as well. The teleconferences, there were three, there are three, we completed two, there's still one to go this semester. They're being held in the telepresence rooms, which are equipped by Cisco systems with the, it's a rather high-tech looking system. They've got a screen, and there are a couple of rows of desks with sound equipment, so we can hear them and they can hear us. And at, during that time, the entire classroom sit down and sort of see your partner in the flesh as well as in the text. A couple of quick takeaways for me. I guess the transnational mindset for me was less about Wolf itself than it was about that sort of personal engagement. But what I did gain from Wolf was the sort of contrasting interest that we bring to that text. My text was to the lighthouse, and I was interested in particular characters. But my partner was interested in, she offered a selection of options as to what we might present about permanence and evanescence, feminist politics, personal politics, comparisons between an earlier text and this one. It was interesting to see what she would start with and what she would bring to that text. Not just in the sense that any two people writing a paper about the same thing will have that sort of connection, but what informed that decision as well. A couple of quick suggestions I would have, I guess, for the next classes, if someone were to do this again. I thought with writing a paper in particular, that ends up being a very personal thing for me and I think for some of my classmates. I thought perhaps bringing forth our correspondence in some sort of a published or publishable way might be nice. And also maybe looking at some particular close readings with that person, I would enjoy that. So I think that's all I've got.
Can I ask you a few questions about that? How big is the class here, and how many students are in the class here?
I think the class here is about 15. And I'd say the class there is at least the same size, maybe a bit bigger.
Have you found this model could be expanded to fit perhaps a larger lecture class, or can it be applied in that setting, do you think?
I mean, the assignment of pen pals is obviously a rather easy thing. I mean, that doesn't strike me as anything that's particularly difficult. The use of the screens and actually seeing the other classroom, I did feel that was valuable because you see these people in the flesh, you see the equipment they're using, you see them reading papers, and then it really brings it home the fact that there's not much difference between us there. I don't know in a larger classroom though, I mean, obviously you're not going to fit them into the telepresence room. So I'm not sure what we would do there.
Do you ever see the lectures that are given in Delhi, and are they exactly? Do you actually prepare them together with the professor at
Delhi
University?
It's a seminar course, and so part of our idea is to think what's going to happen with the new technologies, and we don't want to lose the face-to-face. So for me, it's very profound to sit there, a group of 15 or 16, and look at 16 or 17 on the other side, and this moment when someone makes a joke and you see laughter crossing the circuits, that's a form of connection that
I just want to open it up to our panel to ask, have you had any personal experiences in classes like this? Do you know of any classes that are currently being run in a manner like this or in any other sort of way where we're using technology to link with other universities? I know Dr. Thomas said this.
I'd like to start with a question because, well, now that I just separated you, it seems like it's 12 hours. What time do you actually
quite early, unfortunately. It's going to be about 8 in the morning, which is, I think, 6 p.m. their time.
It's 9.5 hours, so we just make it. And it turns a little bit, I guess this is worth saying, on the generosity of the Fulbright office in central Delhi. We spent some time with the IT people here trying to locate Cisco hotspots. It looked as if the Delhi would have to take the metro out to the airport for an hour and a half to connect up. But Fulbright came through, and that might be a resource worth pressing. I think Fulbright's very disposed to participate and to promote.
How did you make the connection? I mean, how was this initially established? And is
it something that's going to Delhi, and I like always to testify that I thought you were supposed to make friends for life when you were 15, 16, and 17. But it happened to me when I went to Delhi, and we just connected in every which way, including our academic specialties and inspirations. So as I was leaving after a couple months there, he just said, let's not stop. And he had this idea to start partnering. And we're trying to build this as well. There's a group at SOAS, the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, some of you know it, and I've been talking to them about summer school together, also doing a world cinema course that will be located in spots around the world, specialist in Hong Kong cinema with lecture and present a film, and then we would talk across, but also I think we find it valuable to go back to our own community as well, see everything through the teleconferencing. You know, I've loved the sessions we've had, but I wouldn't have wanted to do that for every single class.
Now, we had an experience that's kind of similar to that back in 2001, where we just basically used Polycom, something different than school, continuing professional studies between the time. But basically, it was a seminar type thing. We did our environmental science seminar, we had to overcome the transactional distance, time and space. And how we did that is, we often would all, the faculty members, it was a seminar class, we had about 120 on our side sitting in it for 1 hour, 1 credit hour course. And then our partners would have anywhere from 30 to 50 students in the room. And we would rotate around to different partners in Mozambique and South Africa in 2001. So we used some World Bank equipment. And then for people that had bandwidth, we were able to use the Polycom system. What we had to do is our UVA guys, lecturers here, would give a lecture at 10 a.m. in the morning to that side in the presence of their students. And then our colleagues on that side would give a lecture at 10 o'clock at night back to us. There were only a couple of times we were able to have people in the same space and time. But it, you know, there's a lot to overcome. We published on it. Steve Bacco has done a lot of work with it, taking this type of technology out into the classrooms here. It's spilled over into Omaha to provide more math classes. It's been adopted by, Monticello as well. Another thing, we were just at a conference, IRSLICE, which is the International Association for Research and Service Learning and Civic Engagement. And there's a neat project at UMBC where they're taking and essentially using Orkuchi and GChat and Skype and Facebook for connections in the humanities, which lead to linguistic training for non-native English speakers. And that's being funded by the U.S. State Department in Brazil. So that's something to look into as it builds off your model, other types of things that are more familiar with local cultures. But the sky's the limit, and you guys represent the next generation of how you're going to take this and move it forward in a way that it works.
So are you, are the students who are participating writing any sort of reflection, or are you doing any sort of assessment in terms of the influence that it's had on their learning? Any perspective they might have on how this format is impacting them in any way?
We're not. I'm sure we should, but we didn't because I thought about this, that I didn't want to make it so self-conscious. Ooh, we're having a transnational conversation. I want it to be more, we're having a transnational conversation. I just didn't want to create a level of pedagogical self-consciousness that interfere with the subject matter. Because, you know, I take Boston's point that the excitement is the personal connection. But, you know, I'm doing a course on both of the Bloomsbury group, and I want something to come out of that, the subject matter. The content is what got us together.
It just seems also, too, that at some point in time, because there's so much emphasis now on online learning, which this sort of falls under that larger framework, and arguing for some of the more, you know, I guess, transformative properties of that kind of thing.
Well, let me just plug one thing. The Monday after Thanksgiving, I think it's the 26th of November, we're having a voice and virtuality session with a voice coach from Royal Shakespeare is coming over. And Claire Kenyon teaches Shakespeare, and then Lou Bloomfield teaches how things work, and it's going to be one of the first Coursera courses. And so we want to think about the power of the body in the classroom, the voice in the classroom, and the voice on the screen, and what happens when you virtualize an event like this. And I think there's a lot of discussion we should have it. My own polemic about it is, let's not assume that all the excitement lies with the technology. We have a lot to learn about face-to-face.
I mean, it's interesting that for one of the main connections you had is email, you know, which is a very powerful technology. The work to create that kind of feeling of I'm interested in the infrastructure, you know, how you make something, you know, both interpersonally, but also from the instructor level. I mean, this, just for example, in the Guatemala initiative, they're putting into place a kind of a stroke quality telemedicine link, so, you know, very high quality group or whatever, the language connection. But, you know, for me, the real point is that that's going to be a very reliable connection to talk to your partners and a way to, you know, clearly interact with them and to get a sense of, you know, clearly speaking Spanish, to get over, you know, their English is not as good as our Spanish, you know, to be able to get the nuances of what they're saying. But it's another kind of brick in the set of things, in this house of connections. But it's just another dimension of this other relationship that we're trying to develop. And so that's, when you're, you know, your personal connection with this person, that's what's interesting. So that's, it starts from there. And I think it could go the other way. I mean, it could start from, you know, from the grad student level. If there's a place that you have a connection to, you know, I think that over a few years, very easily you can exploit that to build into and build a connection that, you know, could last through faculty courses.
I do think it also, I mean, you know, for me, the personal relationship is almost more important than the content relationship. But for other students in the course, I mean, I know that they have been headed off in one direction on paper. They've received a message from their partner. They've seen their paper, and that has radically shifted where they want to go. I mean, that too can build a relationship. Pretty confident.
So I'm curious, just to jump in to build a little bit on your point, Ken. Do you have interest in going and seeing and connecting with your colleagues in person? And would you hop on a plane and go there, or vice versa? And the reason I ask that question is because with JPC, we have a lot of students who want to go international, right? They want to get on the plane and land in the village. And then on the other hand, we're kind of saying, well, how can we use technology to supplement or increase engagement in addition to the in-person? So I wonder how to balance that and what you want me to.
Yeah, I mean, in a perfect world, I would have sat down with them for coffee. I mean, that would have been the introduction. You know, I think the financial constraints are obviously the biggest stumbling block for this relationship building. You know, but I do think that this opens up, you know, when it comes time for me to think about, you know, where would I like to apply for fellowships, where would I like to think about moving my career in that way. I do have this connection now. I do have that thought in my mind that Delhi University has the technology to do these kinds of things. You know, what might we go forward doing?
So that might be an interesting assessment for us, just to see, you know, in a couple of years, maybe you end up once you get your PhD working at the University of Delhi, you know, I mean, you don't even apply for any grants, or I wonder what, I don't know, I just get excited about thinking about what 5 years down the road your students might
be. There's also this symmetry, asymmetry question, and it's easier to imagine Austin getting resources to go to Delhi than vice versa. We had it arranged for two of the students to come over, they ran into visa trouble. I'm still not over that emotion. These two wonderful students were going to be here and then take it back. And, you know, if we can think in those terms, but back to your point about personal connection, you know, I think it's great that people up top of the university want to encourage and promote, but really I can see that the events are going to take place when it is faculty, grad student to grad student, and that's really the way to build. And, you know, the resources aren't limited, but have grad students here make connections with people elsewhere. That's something I think we can find resources to promote that and extend that, and not wait for the shell on the top that we have to fill because someone has delivered it by edict.
Well, that's one of the things that I'm thinking about is that, you know, this is part of this whole global citizenship conversation, and really considering all of the options for engagement and thinking what the diverse dimensions of that can be. And maybe it is sort of, I guess, conceptualizing it in phases. So initially we just think about how you develop that engagement, that opportunity for cross-cultural exchange, or however you want to conceptualize it to begin And then it could turn into something else, you know, you open up those opportunities. But maybe that's enough also, you know, and then we can start thinking about how to provide more of those opportunities based on what we have available to us. And also this idea of reciprocity, because I think that is a really big issue here. We have more resources, especially here at this university, than many of our partners might have at this point in time. So I think that there's a lot about this that really, you know, demonstrates a sense of reciprocity that's often very hard to achieve.
To pick up on Michael's point, I think when you go abroad as graduate students, sometimes you talk about transformation and planting the seed and where you could go. And I think for a number of us, we were fortunate enough to have some kind of global experiences earlier in our career, and this led to this. But I think sometimes students are so, this is where it could start. Maybe you could start with awareness amongst the gap, maybe the formal gap fest to say, when we go right across, can we question our own motives for going across? It's more kind of the fact that we're trying to punch the clock and check the box and extract the information we need to last us to belong. Or is it more about making these initial, sitting down and having a cup of coffee with someone that I might end up working with for the rest of my life, getting to know them, this idea of connectivity, and then thinking about how I can take how can I leverage my experience or my opportunities to create a lasting transformative experience for me and the people I'm engaged with. But I think if we could maybe begin to entertain that possibility or even introduce that possibility to incoming graduate students, to outgoing fourth-year students, we might be planting the kinds of seeds and things we'd like to see that would lead to the kinds of things we've heard discuss. But it's a shifting mindset. I don't know how some of you guys, if you've been able to go across, but I think sometimes we keep thinking, I've got to get to this particular place to study this particular thing, because if I don't get it, then I'm not going to be able to get my degree. Without very little regard, if you're talking global, about what are the connections that allow me to get there in the first place.
Yeah. Sounds like a lot of you are involved with preparing, especially undergrads, to go study abroad or research abroad. And I'm curious if there are any sort of events in place for grad students to think more constructively about their own research. I know I can speak for myself and say that I didn't think about my research in this way before I went. It was more about getting the material that I needed to write my dissertation. And as I went, I sort of tried to build these relationships. But I think if I had been more prepared before I left on that front, it might have been a little bit more fruitful.
Where did you go?
I went to India. And I also was in Europe. So I was gone for 2 years. And I had lived in India before, but this was like, you know, travel back and forth between museums for a year straight and look for paintings. So, and that can sometimes distract, I think, from the broader picture of building these lasting, meaningful relationships. So I'm curious if you know of any things that are in place for grad students, and if you think, I mean, I'm hoping maybe this could be something that the GAB Council can provide for grad students. And also, if you can maybe speak about your experience with undergrads, how you compare them, and do you think that that's something that you apply grad student preparation for research abroad?
I'll jump in and say, and I don't want to speak for my colleagues, but my sense is that we're not doing enough. So, apologies, we should be doing more. The core seminars that are being offered, for example, studies office and academy advancements, the world times, I think those are a great start. But I would love to see them go in a different direction. Just even from talking to Krista just on Monday, I've already been starting to think about how can we help graduate students think about their research in a different way, their experiences in college. I think that's just a to-do item we should all be
doing. That was one of the outcomes of the assessment for JVC, wasn't it? That graduate student advisors might need a little bit more preparation themselves or mentoring.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. And so just to give a quick piece of background on that, we just released some 100-page report. You don't need to read the whole thing. There is an executive summary on top of it, but it is an assessment of the JVC program, kind of a baseline evaluation for where we're at. And one area in need of enhancement and further development is working with graduate mentors. Part of that is that I think what we found is that each graduate student has such a different role with their JVC team that's a little hard to figure out how to design pre-departure orientation
what you may need for their project as opposed to trying to do a one-size-fits-all implementation. But I think that that's an overarching concern with preparation to begin with.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, from an institutional standpoint, there are people who argue for a sequence of courses that every undergraduate would have to experience before being able to go out into the field. And then there are other people who argue, you know, that there really isn't a sequence of courses, that it really is sort of dependent upon lots of other factors. And, you know, it's still a big debate, so I imagine it's no different for graduate students than it is for undergraduates, really. However, I do think that there's a little bit more research in the field that speaks to particular skills and more along the lines of soft skills than hard skills. You know, content, specialty skills, which, you know, as someone who works with pre-service teachers, I can say being a content specialist doesn't make you a good teacher or a good advisor or a good mentor. And I think that that's sort of where we're a little caught now in terms of preparation for undergrads or for faculty, for that matter. Because, I mean, I think that faculty is often left out of this conversation altogether in terms of preparation. And so that's another dimension of this conversation. It's, it would be hard to be able to provide the kinds of experiences that undergrads or graduate students would need to have if the faculty themselves are still sort of a little ambivalent or unprepared for these experiences as well, so.
I'm Peter Walman, architect. We have a new program, actually, that's based in Delhi. My kind of program that's based there, so interesting. This, I think one day, as graduate students who become alumni, an architecture program actually started with a date with an alumnus from India who's now a graduate here in my first year in 92. It was last year, we've been in touch ever since. But there are international alumni out there who have been former graduate students, army graduates, and that's a way that they actually, if you keep up the conversation with them, they suddenly, you know, they move in some ways. You can imagine the contrast very quickly. You know, when I first got to India 3D21 thing, 2 years ago, well, he showed me his work. He showed me his remarkable research and all that. I came back with his book and gave it to the dean, and she invited him to be the keynote speaker for Brandon Open House. At this point, he was so amazing. He said, program. So what we're doing in Grace, what I'm suggesting is you discover new people, but also you have international students here who are remarkable, because three young folks from Grace, and that's a, another letter, another constituency, I guess, that you all build upon. We're proud of them as students, we should be proud of them 10, 20, 30 years later, and keep up with them. So that's why our program includes these interviews, because the major figures are there. And I've accomplished it, and I've pointed out a distant shore from the character of Bobby, which basically means he's frequently coming. So we use advanced technologies in Skype, and since we're architectural visual, we have to not only say this, but we've all got this model or this drawing, so the visual capacities to be there and pointing out. You know, communication works on that level, but it certainly works on a visual level and also a generational level as well. It's impressive, 15 or whatever. It's actually nice to know some people over a certain period of time and build it on that conversation.
And this is something you took upon yourself to start, or was it something that the university was, I mean, it's sort of for all these programs, I'm curious. Is this, you kind of have to reach out on your own and then?
I was invited to a conference in India, traveling 26 hours each way and being there for 7 days, just because India was not on my list. At which point I found it was amazing to hear. Pankaj, I'll take back to Dean, initiated it because she came down to my big old house in the beginning thereafter as a visiting graduate critic. He put it into it. And since I had only been 72 hours in India, Dean Crispin, one of our colleagues, had spent about 20 years there traveling and very much into programs with ISO. She said that's going to be an ISO project, so that's what we did last year. 14 students, 10 graduate students, and 4 undergraduates, and it's a great success, and now we have 29 people applying. We'd like to actually open it up beyond the architecture to the school and actually to promote their university. And so it's a great time, writing grants, but it's through ISO, I guess, the vehicle now, and it's a summer 6-week program.
I just want to share my personal experience and get back to the graduate student. How do you get them prepared for that? When I can only speak from my perspective. And I'm aware of what you call it, the cup at the top has to be full before it trickles on us or something. Or maybe I just added it to it. But in the absence of being trickled on by the top, I've had to come up with more creative ways to be entrepreneurial. So what I've tried to do with my graduate students is work them in as TAs over a course, over a number of courses, so it's a way to diversify the funding scheme. And one of the things that I can say, there's two ways to look at this, because you're asking what can the graduate students, what does the university provide to graduate students to help them become prepared to be properly mentored. But I would also say that you all have the power, you have the right, and you already have the agency to ask when you're getting ready to take on a graduate student program, what is your philosophy, your personal philosophy on mentoring graduate students? Where do your graduate students go? These are some things that can be done proactively. Maybe through GapFest, coming with a little cheat sheet or tips of how you approach graduate student mentors and such, that might be questions you ask up front. Expectations, transparency, group communication. The other thing is if you're interested in international, asking the question, having the discussion really early on. Gee, I'm interested in having this, your international scholar, you got a neat program going on here in the humanities. What potential is there for myself to grow into this and actually move through the educational process? Because what I've done is getting graduate students over as TAs. The ticket costs the same amount whether they're there for the course or whether they stay on another 6 weeks. So how do you leverage? How do you extend? And that's what we've had to do in the absence of.
So, I mean, I've been getting really interested in the thought of joint mentorship. Part of what I've been finding and connecting more deeply with people at Dell University is realizing they would be amazing figures, some of them, for dissertations that are being written in the English department. And when I was there, I met people in history and say, we have the best South Asian history in the world. We have a department of 27, 26 of us are South Asian historians of high magnitude. But we don't do anything else around the world. So their anxiety is that they need to connect with others. And I went back to talk to people history here and said, we don't do anything in South Asia of note. So the possibility for educating together, having people in Delhi who are on dissertation committees of someone here, you know, I think that's something we could move to in the near term.
So certainly with JPC, part of what's built into that is the recognition that the community partner is an expert and a contributor and a co-educator, and that's the part of the philosophy we've tried to build into the structure of the program. But seeing that spirit start to pervade in other ways of educating students would be fabulous. I also want to flag a really interesting challenge, and something that I wrestle with professionally here at UVA, is how to balance what I hear is sort of that spark, that personal connection that happens between two individuals. You know, neighbors are talking while they're mowing the lawn, or you end up at a conference and something happens. And versus things are more structural, things are more mechanistic. So, you know, I'm always weary of people who want structures, they want things to go bigger, the more institutionalized. And where I sit, I listen to sound very ironic. Everyone always question that because I never want to structure programs get so established that it feels like we're squashing this wonderful personal spark. New friends get made all because, you know, surprise or happy accidents seems to somehow be part of all this, and I hope that the structure that we build only help for that unexpected development. So I would never mind to feel like it just makes it sound like these are the ways you do it, and if you step off the path, will lead to you. I mean, it should be, get up and down, there are great things that come out last week. So I just want to flag that as an ongoing tension in this kind of work, but I think it's a really generative tension and something that we shouldn't rush to resolve or rush to sort of smooth. I think we should just kind of figure out how to support all of it in some sort of magic way. I don't know what it is.
I just wanted to ask you all about an article I just read in the Quant called about Fulbright. I don't know if you've heard, but Fulbright is now offering short-term fellowships for academics. The idea being that more people will be willing to go for shorter periods of time. But as someone who was on Fulbright, their primary goal seems to always been cultural immersion. And I just wonder if these types of grants are, A, can you still immerse yourself culturally? I mean, I think it's possible, certainly, but I think we have to think about how we go about doing that. And do you think this is sort of the trend in funding for study, for research abroad, that we're now moving more and more towards shorter-term fellowships, and potentially ones where we go back and forth multiple times over 3 years, say, for a week or two each time, as opposed to moving somewhere for a year? I just want to know your opinions on how you think that will work. Is it good? Is it bad? And, yeah.
I mean, I think it's a good option to have. Certainly because of the engineering school, and there are a lot of constraints there. So most of the students that do study abroad do the short term because their schedule is so packed. So it's good to have, but I mean, for me, for that to really work, you have to have a lot of preparation in advance. You know, for the Guatemala stuff, we, you know, force them to take a workshop. We ask them to take a workshop, you know, which is all about cultural preparation, the ethics of doing youth work, and also to take fairly intensive Spanish language via Skype, which is kind of astonishing that you can do that just one-on-one instruction with somebody going on. But again, for me, it's less about the single event and about kind of continuity. And you know, having, you know, you have this ongoing program where you have all different levels of relationships with the place, different people, different partners, and you have students come in, hopefully, at different points. You know, through courses that you offer, you know, the course that Dr. Bob, and you know, there are a variety of other ones that people taught. And you kind of try to hold on to them, so it's a long, you stretch out the experience. So that you have before, during, and after, and you know, maybe then another, where they go back as a mentor. You know, we've had students that have been in different times. So, I guess, you know, I think short term is fine as long as it has that kind of broader support.
Dr. Brown, can I ask you also, with the study abroad program, do you do a similar preparation and also maybe get from this fellowship
from you? Yeah, over the last 10 years, it seems like we've moved more and more to these short classes just by student demand and thought it. So, like we're saying, for all the reasons where it's not enough time, but just decide, take those 2 weeks and really make it really special version. Now, if you're traveling on your own, it's a little harder to do, but I think it's kind of better than I would have thought. Instead of having lots of free time and stuff, we just don't people like it. And I think that's a good thing. So everybody's, I mean, maybe it's the places I go, people typically end up just going to bars at night. I'm tired, and get up early and start the next day, and it actually works pretty well. And I think there's something to be said for having that, you know, all you're doing, a project, and the people you work with, and having to do this intense thing. Although I like the idea of coming, so I think that if you as an individual went someplace, I like the continual thing, but I found I try to have the class, the ends when it's over. We don't come back and try and drag it out for the semester, because now I get caught up in this life. It'd be great to hang on to it, but I think we just want to have the best experience you can have during those 2 weeks. So much variety. Anomaly teaching business class. I don't do that much business, it's just the context, and it's for visiting churches, and just all sorts of different experiences. As much as we can really pack into that time. So I think it's quite useful. I think if you go someplace for 2 days, you go a lot more than four. If you stay doing it, it's a lot more than 2 days. 2 weeks for a week, 6 months is always a very bad thing. Some sort of learning curve that comes off of you, you know, use your time well enough. That's worth a lot. So I encourage the short courses to turn out a lot better than I would have thought.
Your students end up not able to see too. So again, you sort of light, you know, ignite that spark and then they working on it, and then they can apply for grants. So, I think it's back to your point, Krista, what are the structures, and you're going to apply that again, so I'm just using structures. But what are the structures in place that allow that kind of episodic visiting to a site and then also processing and keeping the relationships going while you're here? So I think there's some reliance on these positions in higher education.
That triggered something. So speaking for undergraduates, but I think it'd be the same thing for graduate students. I've become more and more enamored with sending first years or something like that. So if you wait until you know it, then you go check it out. And that's useful, but if there's something you said, you're going over there getting excited about something that can direct the rest of your studies. So I have a student with me to make a rock with, who came back, so it was the third year at the time, grandma thought I was. Very special student. So one night, we're talking about business ethics or something, ethics for the nationalization. He wrote a paper next week. So overnight, he wrote a 15-page paper that was so much more complex here. And makes for known details. Well, this gets so we came back and said, set up some context. I'd like to go back there and study some environmental things. I said, I think we should go to Bangladesh. So we set up the thing in Bangladesh. By the time that finished, we interviewed all these people and applied for a full grant, which eventually he won. By that time, he was already accepted in the doctoral program, so he thought about it. And now he's at Vanderbilt, starting a doctoral program. Working in Bangladesh because, for whatever, just the way life works out, Vanderbilt got a 5-year contract with the U.S. Navy to cooperate with Bangladesh on disaster relief and stuff, which is exactly what he was doing. So there's a lot to be said for just showing up, doing stuff that life kind of presents itself to you if you're waiting to prepare.
From a graduate perspective as well, like not being a fifth year, I mean, a first year, I mean, certainly understand that the closer you get to sort of another choke point where it's time to apply, it's time to put together that dissertation committee, the more anxious you will become about it. So I think there is sort of a limited window as to opening your mind to that sort of thing, to where maybe my dissertation committee doesn't have to be three professors here at the top of my field, maybe I can look elsewhere. But I'm not sure that you would think that way.
I'd suggest you find ways to be a graduate mentor for a JPC or find some double Google group where you're working with an undergrad and just make these contacts and just build these up so much. That's the idea of going back. These students just keep going back. And then by the time they graduate and write them in a recommendation, I can't believe how much they've done. They're only 20 or something like that. It's a cool kind of theory.
She went with one of the McRobb team. She was a nursing student, did her PhD there, but her dissertation work mapped on perfectly to what the JBC team was doing.
So this woman was in the master's program in nursing. She wrote and said, could I sign up for your grant for your program and make it up with that check? And actually said, no, it's on that credit. So I said, okay, maybe I'll take her as a TA. So she did that, and then into the doctor program. She said, and he wasn't supposed to have paper, I would have left my nurse to TA. So that's great. Then she ended up doing her research in that place. And now she's at the University of Miami, still researching and setting up the office. So things, you just end up getting a special, you know, the world must have billions of things you could do. But if you're sitting here, you can't figure it out. Do you have any funny sleep things?
I think it depends. With the Fulbright, my name is Jenny Wasser. I was a Fulbright scholar. And later, I ran the Washington chapter of the alumni bunch. There is a network set up in Fulbright between the American Fulbrights and those who have had Fulbrights to this country, from that country. And I think it really depends on the Fulbright organization over there. I mean, I was in Europe, but some places, they're very efficient. To the Japanese ones, very efficient and so on. But others, they're not. I mean, they really don't check out. You write an application, they don't check. You're going to be there for a year or even a shorter time. And they don't check out what the facilities are that you're going to go to. And I think that if you can at least contact someone who's had a Fulbright, you should call the alumni bunch in Washington, they will tell you who's had one and what university, where they are right now. as an American, and then you can find people over there and network with them. And they will even help you by going to the place, the archive or whatever it is you're trying to do. They will help you in that way, and usually they will communicate at least, which is good. It really does save time, I think, when you get over there. Precious time, too.
I just wanted to piggyback off that. I was a Fulbright light. I was number 6 in the program of the Fulbright Senior Specialist. So it was a guinea pig in that sense. I went to Mozambique 2 times for 6 weeks each throw. And that resulted in us recruiting a couple of graduate students to come here. They finished their PhDs and gone back to Norma Adi, and now they're working with us and we're mentoring their students. And that was 10 years ago. So it depends on what you do. I know other Fulbright scholars, as I'm sure you have, have gone on like that, a very personal, fulfilling thing. But it didn't result in many connections. And I think it goes back to Brad's point. I'm a believer in this idea. I don't use the term shock at all with the connotations, but this idea of cognitive dissonance that's caused by being overly tired and keeping undergrads out of bars is something I find to be highly effective in changing mindsets. So I think if we go with a continuum, if we go with exposure, it can lead to some of these longer terms, or the longer terms can lead to the short terms. I think being open to it, walking through doors, knocking on doors, graduate students coming through and asking questions and realize that you're not some form of indentured servant, I think that's the first good step if we're going forward.
And going back to the point that Megan made before about, the caution of becoming too so structured that it becomes sort of limiting, because this is a nice interplay, these experiences between sort of serendipity, like who you end up in class with, literally, and how the ground is sort of prepared for you to make something of it. Because ultimately, that's what happens, is we all make something of these opportunities, or not. But then that's where the structure sort of comes into play, right? I mean, if we're talking about engagement, then that means that everyone who's in that context is engaged. So that means as faculty person, I'm attentive to what's happening with the undergraduates and the graduate students who I'm in contact with. I'm not just saying, oh, well, here's the experience, you take it and run with it, right? That can happen to some extent, but especially in terms of your question of graduate student preparation, if I'm working with a graduate student, much like the people who were my mentors when I was a graduate student, halfway through my graduate coursework, I realized I wasn't developing any skills. I was just taking classes and writing papers, and there was no skill building there. And so, I happened to find the few people who I thought would be willing to help me build those skills, and it completely changed my trajectory. But somebody had to be responsive to that as well. So I think this whole idea of engagement really is that, yes, we do provide opportunities for people to be able to understand what the options are in terms of putting their academics to work. That applies, it's that engaged scholarship paradigm. But if we're really engaged in this, we're okay with this dissonance, with that gray area going back and forth between allowing the space for people to make sense of their experiences, but also providing the structure when that structure is necessary. And I think that's the part that we have a hard time with, because we seem to be more either or than both and at this point in time. So I think that's where the conversation is right now, as far as I can tell. Yeah.
I think we've all told heartwarming stories, and they're very personal and powerful. It does seem to me, as I listen, that the best thing for grad students would be to know these are the places to go, and this is when the lane leaves. That UVA has a connection in Delhi, Nicaragua, Guatemala, London, Lyon, and then you agitate inside departments and say, come up with 5 airfares, because it's the airfare. And when you get there, now you have a relationship, it's not that expensive to stay on for 3 weeks, 6 weeks.
We should let departments have credit cards with no little points.
Right.
Just give out 5 miles.
I should open up to a question that I hoped to do this earlier, but I was interested in what I was saying. So if anyone here has any questions for our panelists or anything you'd like to ask, we're getting close to the end of our time. Yes.
It's just a comment, but I just want to say, I think one of the wonderful things about the JPC has been that it's provided funding for undergraduate students who wouldn't otherwise have the financial support to take an international course, to pay for the airfare and the additional tuition and all of that. And I think that's really had life-changing experiences on the students that I've supervised in those programs. So I think it's so great that you're thinking about doing the technology and the international. I hope we keep the opportunities for students, particularly students who would not have had the means to do it. I think it's a really great thing.
I'd like to make one more pitch for Stella Blue, where everybody knows about it. But I've supervised several, and they're just so easy. It seems like every time they apply, I guess they must not be very easy. I just find some undergraduate that's kind of interested in the same thing. I would say you aren't really a mentor, but a little bit. But you get this big program set up, and it ends up being kind of like a little meeting JPC.
Yeah.
It could be just going to London and doing research in libraries and stuff like that. So it doesn't call out the service. It's just really quite neat.
Is there some sort of online forum or any sort of place where grad students can find these undergrads that are interested in?
I don't know. But you have, if you're in environmental science, you have professionals that know undergraduates or something, so there must be some way to.
And I think the Global Development Organization LISERV might also be a good place
sure.
to put out an announcement or to generate some sort of interest. They seem to have a very wide base. We have a Facebook page for JPC, so we encourage students to post there. It's just like smiling, this is like a come full circle back to how we use technology to use the international. It's possible we've been able to solve our team hires to puzzle over how to get person with skill set A matched up with person who need A. It seems simple, but it's
actually something that has come up in CAB meetings and something that we want to develop. So one of our digital initiatives, Laura Turek, who's in politics, who's not here right now, but she is sort of heading that up with the Scholars Lab. So hopefully we'll get that going by the end of the year.
Well, speaking of just following up on you again here, I do have a group of students in computer science who have a lot of technical skills in building apps and are really interested in partnering with any kind of project. Either a community engagement project, a research project, where an app development will be at least. So that's a pretty sweet skill set.
Yeah.
I would be so happy. Yeah. I have a student who speaks Spanish who's looking to partner with someone. She's abroad right now, so that's another challenge for students who are away right now and want to plug into the VA things. But right now, it's just in my inbox.
I just also wanted to second the possibility that one of the things that CAB could do would be to create a kind of bulletin board of opportunities and also to match graduate students who have had experiences abroad, because it seems to me that, there are, from what you've said, across schools, there are a number who have this rich experience. If we could bring them together around countries of interest, India, China, I think the graduate-to-graduate conversation could be quite useful in terms of preparation, and then matching undergrads and graduates and having something on this central website could be quite valuable. Apart from ISO, because it is a bit different.
There are alumni organizations, though, everywhere. The Fulbright Hayes, Fulbright, of course, the various grants that you find. They all have offices, and they all know where their alums are, and they'll give you all that information, and you can just call them up and ask them, is this possible in this environment, where are you going? And they're glad to talk about their alum.
One other thing, that there are different departments, certain ones that specialize in certain regions, like studies or Spanish, or they probably are undergraduate listeners. Same thing for anthropology, a field like that, that's I'm sure if you're interested in a place, you can find the right. I'd really like to do something. So, it's
builds up through your school card box as a graduate student, and then you get your degree and you're gone. And then it just leads us to go back to square one and do it again and again. And there hasn't really been a good sense of handoff. That's been my experience. So, you know, I think we say the same thing every time. And I know it would help the larger programs if we had some sense of continuity. And one of the things that we've been trying to stress with this stuff that we've been doing in South Africa for a long time, with Guatemala as well, JPC as well, and for us, this is idea of a continuum. And that you can constantly plug back into a bigger network. So while you're trying to maybe transit, there's some experience base you can build off. I think that plus is your position, like, gee, I wish I had done these things before. Cautionary note to anybody who wants to do these things in the future, ask these questions before you go. Look at these programs and have like a blog space or something. You can do it because otherwise, you know, a lot of scale vanishes later, it's all gone.
We all love to think about what we can do as an organization. And please, if you're interested in any of the things we talked about today, continue to look at our website. We'll be updates there, hopefully. And feel free to contact us through the website if you have any questions.
And if there are any grad students who are part of GAB,